good morning. Having a good time. Yeah. Tea lovers in the house, give me a cheer. Tea lovers in the house. Yeah. Coffee lovers in the house, give me a cheer. You should definitely try tea. It tastes way better than coffee. You should definitely try. Okay, so hello everyone, my name is Indranils Chandra and I'm going to start with a question. When was the last time when you built something really useful? When was the last time? When you build something, it's going to make a difference to someone else. Yeah, you remember, sir? When was it? Around 2 years back. What did you build, sir? That's great, sir. We will definitely talk about after this talk, right? Yeah. So, that's what the question is, right? So, that was the last time you really built something useful. So, in the next 10-15 minutes, we are going to discuss about that and look into how can we really build something really useful. Okay? So, my name is Indranils Chandra. I am an innovator, maker, engineer, researcher, and a healthcare actor. And on the days when I am really frustrated, I also do stand-up comedy. And also write stuff. So, I have hands in pretty much everything. Yeah. So, getting started with the question, what is machine learning? Anyone wants to take a wild guess to that? Yeah. Anyone in the audience knows what's the difference between machine learning and artificial intelligence? Okay, so let's have a small crash course on machine learning. Okay. So, artificial intelligence or AI is any system which is smart enough to take decisions on their own. Whereas machine learning is a subdomain of artificial intelligence which uses data to do the same. That's the only difference. I know it's very blurred still, but we'll try to figure out what is the exact difference between all these things. Okay. So that's what machine learning is. So if you tell a 4-year-old boy and teach him that, hey, this is how an apple looks, this is how an apple tastes and everything, so the boy would start to learn that whenever the next time he sees an apple, he would be able to predict that it's an apple, right? So that's how machine learning systems essentially work. So the only key to build a good machine learning algorithm is to keep these things in mind. The more data, more questions you ask, and the better answers you get. So let's say that you taught the 4-year-old boy with an apple which is red in color. So the boy might have thought that apples are always red in color. What if it grows up to be a 10-year-old kid and comes across an apple which is green in color? Now that's out of the question, right? Out of the syllabus kind of question. So the algorithm really needs to be smart enough to detect a green apple as well. And that's when more data comes into the picture. If you would have taught that guy, that kid at 4 years old, when he was 4 years old itself, that hey, apples can be red as well as green as well. So he would have been more smarter by the time he grew up to be 10 years old. Right? So that's what the key is to build any machine learning algorithm. The more data you have, the more questions you ask, and the better answers you get. So I'll start with my own story. How did I get started? So they started when I was in my second year of engineering, which was way back in 2013. So I was interning with MIT Media Lab's health tech team. So I was working on a device over there, which was trying to kind of figure out how to take images of your wounds and predict whether the wound is healing or not. At first, that sounds like a moonshot idea, and really impossible to achieve that, right? But when we started building it, it was very simple at the end to build it. And we built it entirely from scratch within like 20 days or so. So I'll start how we did that. So this is how the device looks actually. So those white things that you see, those are basically lasers which actually illuminates the wound. The thing in the center of those lasers, the black circle that you see, that's basically the camera which takes images of the wound. And then you predict whether the wound is healing or not. So the wounds are something like this. So here you can see below the foot, you can see a diabetic ulcer, a patch that you see, right? So we took images of this wound and we constructed these maps. So these are basically perfusion maps. And it says how your blood flow velocity is varying with time. So what it says is for the 650 nanometer wavelength, you see something like this. So the red regions are the one where the blood flow velocity is more, and the blue regions are the one where the blood flow velocity is less. So it shows that gradient. Now here's the point. If you have a bull, there is probably a pus formation over there, which means that the fluid over there is not flowing with a high velocity. So that would show a bluish region, which you can see near the boundary of the ulcer. So that was kind of the proof of concept that we went on to prove with this research. And it really inspired us to think of it this way, how can we really use this to solve a real problem. So we started with the testing of this device in hospitals and all. Now, one of the things that we went on to do next is use this maps to predict whether the wound is healing or not. So we wanted just to give a yes or a no to the doctor. The wound is healing, the wound is not healing. As simple as that. So we feed it to a machine learning algorithm and get that result. Now, at the end of this all, at the end of this 20 days of internship, the question that was left with is that we can really use machine learning for a cause. And I was kind of very motivated that we can really do it. So I started thinking of ideas, how can I build multiple things, build different things to solve a real problem. And I ended up with this. So everyone now in the audience now knows who is my favorite android. So this is what you end up building if you're really in love with someone and also want to code at the same time. So you want to build a machine learning algorithm, but you want to only feed images of the image that you want to see. So this is what I ended up doing. So I ended up building a gender classifier which takes images of the person and telling whether the person is a male or a female. As simple as that. So here basically I took all the facial features, the eyes, the nose, the mouth, the lips and everything. And I was taking their coordinates in relation to each other to construct various features. And here's the thing, you might argue that this is, you're not solving a real problem, you're just doing some fun stuff. But it really helped me in solving a real problem when I went to Sujana Innovation Center, which is a center in LBPI Hospital in Hyderabad. So we were building something called as pediatric perimeter. So what pediatric perimeter does is, it detects sight vision loss in infants. Now it's one of the serious problems because for most of the infants, they don't respond to the tests which are carried out for detecting sight loss. Right? So we wanted to figure out today how we can do that. So what we ended up doing is we started giving visual stimuli in the form of lighting at different angles in front of the infant. And if the infant saw that towards that lighting, it meant that they can see that light. Like a simple contour, right? So we had an entire dome with an entire chain of LED lights, illuminated LED lights at different angles and saw whether the infant was responding to that light or not. And here's the thing, we wanted to automate this procedure, whether the infant is reacting or not. So we wanted to build a case tracking algorithm which served the purpose. And that's where this algorithm that I had built, the basis of this algorithm, finding the facial features, whether eyes, nose, mouth, really helped me in developing this case tracking algorithm wherein we were predicting where the infant is moving around. This really again motivated me that hey, you can really solve a real problem if you want to. Like, I started attending as a hackathons. I think everyone over here at some point of time must have attended a hackathon or must have come across that word. So hackathons are cool, always. I have Weber Youngle with me here and we together have attended like more than a dozen of hackathons, winning almost each one of them. Hackathons are always cool if you want to develop an idea, develop a proof of concept and see whether it works or not. So this is one of the recent things that we built. So in the news you have always seen that banks are being fined for not complying with the AML regulations. AML is anti-money laundering. So the regulators say that if a terrorist or someone is using your bank to transfer money, then you are at the cost of it because you are paying tax. So I'm going to fine you. If you don't have a system in place which monitors all of these suspicious activities, I'm going to fine you. So these are how the major banks in India and across the world are being fined right now because of this problem. So we went ahead and built something called as a machine learning detector, money laundering detector. So what it does is it takes your transaction data and it predicts whether that transaction is fraudulent or not. So it makes a difference because right now the systems that we have in place, they have a 95% false positive rate, which means that out of every 100 alerts that are generated, 95 of them are not supposed to be alerts. But those 95 are still being reviewed by the operations team to see whether they are fraudulent transactions or not. So it is increasing the operations cost. So we tried to solve that problem by building this money laundering detector. ML out of nowhere. So this is one of the dream projects of mine which has been going on for the last 2 years. It's called Dhwani. It's an augmented and alternative communication device for people suffering from paralysis to help them communicate with people around them. Now, if you can see at the top, there is a LCD screen where the Dhwani part is written. There's an LCD screen at the back of it, and there's a microphone near the mouth. So what we used to do is we used to display a pattern of alphabets on the LCD screen and take the breathing intensity of the user as a feedback whether they want to select an alphabet or not. Right. So if you see an A on the screen, if you want to select A, you do a so as simple as that. So this is what we had built. There was no machine learning in that. But here's the problem. If you wanted to consider the word hello, you could start from A, go till H. First, then you would start from E, start from A and go to E. Then you would go to L. So that actually increased the rate at which words were constructed, right? So we wanted to solve that problem, and we used something as simple as the Google's PageRank algorithm. So when Google was launched, they used a PageRank algorithm to predict whether if you are on page A, what is the possibility of going to page B? And accordingly, they rank the indexes of the pages, right? So we use an algorithm very similar to that, which kind of rank the indexes of the words and try to predict the next word and the next alphabet. We use the algorithm for both purposes. So that increases the speed of the device by more than 2x. And this is what the second prototype looked like. Now here's the thing. All these things that we were doing, they're all research work. And to be very frank, research is not always scalable. It is not always. Most of the research that we do always stays inside the laboratories. They never go out of the laboratories. They never go out of the labs. So we really need to do something which we need to build products. Because products are always scalable. If from the scratch itself, you think of building an ecosystem, an entire product, you always end up being built the right product. That's what I'm trying to say. So there's a difference between building projects and building products. So first of all, it's not a product if it's not scalable. Second one, the motive of research or the intent of research is to validate your idea, not to build a product. So these are two different things. So you do research, you build a small project or something, you validate your idea. And then you go on and build a product which you want to scale up and you know actually solve a real problem. But these two are independent entities right now. And what I always try to do is think of it from the scratch itself. Think of it from the start that you want to build a product. And do your research in that manner itself. So in that way, whatever proof of concept you are developing, you can easily take it out there in the market as soon as possible with minimal time. So these are a few of the kids whom we have ended up helping. So we have been working with the Sussex Society of India for the last 1 year almost, testing our device called Bunny over there and helping the paralytic kids. So these are a few of the names who we have ended up helping. And you can do it too, if you really want. You just need to think of it that way. You need to think of it to build something, to build for a cause. Thank you. So these are some of the names that you can visit if you want to play out. So any questions? No questions? Anyone wants to argue about why coffee is better than tea? And no one? Unless another. Yeah. Yes.
Are those projects open source? Are those projects open source?
So, if I talk about money laundering detector, it's something that I just built 2 minutes back in a hackathon. It's I've still not uploaded it on GitHub. It's going to be uploaded by tonight, so you can see the code there. The first project won, so it's a research done by MIT Media Labs, and right now won wound analysis device. It's incubated in IIT Bombay, signed IIT Bombay, and I'm not part of the team right now, but there's a guy called as Deepak Kumar, so you can get in touch related to that. He can explain you more about the project. And the last part, money, it's not open source yet. Few of the earlier versions of money are open source. It's on the GitHub profile. But right now, the current prototype that we are building, it's not yet matured enough to be open source. Yeah. Any other questions?
Really appreciate kind of this.
I had a question, like you have been hearing about machine learning for long, and we haven't seen anything which is in use, from machine learning, but you all artificial intelligence. So question like you've been part of so many companies. Is there any product which is in use right now? Which is
So here's the thing. So that's what the whole talk is about, right? We really want to build products which go into the market and help people. So that is actually an example of that. Because it's a 2 year long project. It has been going on for 2 years right now. And it's at a very mature stage right now. We are working with real life patients and kids and whatever. And even with the case of Bond, it's an incubated startup right now, which is carrying out testing and validation at a very large scale with a lot of problems. So if you think of it that way, yes, it can be productionized. I'm not saying that you can productionize it overnight, but you can definitely reduce the time required to do that if you really think of it from the start when you're building it to build a product instead of just doing this. So yes, from my perspective, of those projects are actually money is going to be live soon, and one is already there. Any more questions? Any questions? We still have some time? We still have some? Yeah? A minute, 21 more question? Oh, thank you so much.